Hello and welcome to today's webinar. I'm Nick Zulovich from Subprime Auto Finance News and Buy Here Pay Here Report. In today's webinar, the Digital Marketer's Guide, Survival Guide, How to Manage the Declining Returns from SEM, we're going to learn more about this topic from Ian Cruikshank of SpeedShift Media. But before we get started, I want to go over a few housekeeping items for today's webinar. Please make sure you've dialed in using the phone number provided in your communication email, or you're able to listen via your PC speakers. We are recording today's webinar, and we'll make the recording and presentation or the recording available to you in the coming days. You'll be in listen-only mode for this webinar, but we will reserve some time after the presentation for a Q&A session. You can submit your questions at any time through the questions box on the GoToWebinar control panel. And if we aren't able to get to your question today, don't worry, because we'll forward it on to the team at SpeedShift Media so they can respond back to you directly via email. And lastly, if you have any difficulty during the webinar, please click on the hand icon on the GoToWebinar control panel to alert a member of our webinar team. So now I'd like to introduce today's presenter, SpeedShift Media's Ian Cruikshank. Ian has spent more than 10 years in marketing and digital advertising. As the VP of Sales and Marketing for SpeedShift Media, he is the head of all revenue generating activities. With a master's in business and IT management and as an adjunct professor at the University of British Columbia, he is regularly called on to present and lecture on a variety of information technology and digital marketing concepts. So without further ado, let's get to our presentation. Ian, the webinar is now yours.
Perfect, perfect. Thank you very much, Nick. Thank you for the intro, and thanks for having us as a webinar guest. You know, we've done a fair bit of work and been featured in some of your blogs and articles over the years for automotive remarketing, and we appreciate our partnership. So thank you for having us at this time. And folks, this should be a good piece, hopefully giving you tools that you're going to be able to use right away, as well as to give you a bit of a framework to assess some new tools that you can use in the marketplace. Clearly, there's a lot of change afoot, and that's not really going to stop for any length of time now. You know, the pace of change just continues on and on. So I was previously sort of described here, so I won't spend too much time introducing myself. This is me, the visual me. I can turn on my camera, but I don't know that you want to see the headset wearing me, so we'll just stick to that. Instead, you can see this guy. This is my Halloween version. So in recent years, it was Napoleon Dynamite. My wife and I were actually just recently Han Solo and Leia, and she was Han. So I don't take myself too seriously. Like most Canadians, we like to have a bit of fun. We get poked at in the way of fun. If you guys know these guys, Bob and Doug McKenzie, or if you've seen a little South Park, you know, we get blamed for a lot of things. And heck, why not? We're a bit of a silly crew. This is how we vandalize. Pretty straightforward. You know, we're a polite bunch. We say sorry a lot, so I apologize for that, or sorry, if you will. But don't, you know, mess with our hockey, because then we do get a little more serious. This is post-losing to Boston, a little bit ridiculous. Things got a bit out of hand, kind of like our real estate market. If you're familiar with that, real estate in the Vancouver area is absolutely out of control. I highly recommend coming here to visit. I don't necessarily recommend coming here to buy a house, because we play a game called Crack Shack or Mansion. Crack Shack or Mansion is effectively a game that goes around on the internet all the time, and you see houses like this. So you might guess that this is a crack shack. Actually, it was a marijuana grow op, another fun thing about Vancouver, but this was a marijuana grow op, and it is worth $1.1 million. You could probably put a little time and effort into it and transfer ownership or sell it again in the marketplace for $2 million. So not a bad place to make real estate investments, but you need the money to get in. And this is why. We live in this beautiful place surrounded by water and mountains, and we have a really, really great time. It inspires a lot of things, a lot of creativity. It also inspires a lot of thought in the digital marketplace, quite a hotbed in the Canadian marketplace for digital and globally, really. We've lived here and been here as a company for about 13 years. And really, if you go back in time, just to give you a bit of an overview of our world, we've been an enterprise company, an enterprise technology company, building solutions for folks that you already probably work with. So you may already be de facto a client of ours. If you're working with Autotrader.com, Cars.com, or Edmunds, you're likely utilizing solutions that we have developed for them. As the market has shifted in the last while, we have actually taken it upon ourselves to build and utilize some of the technology into a subsection that we call the Auto Audience Network. So the Auto Audience Network is our four dealer solution. So we work directly with dealers and with a lot of agencies. If you're working with an agency partner, you can always ask them about the Auto Audience Network. And effectively what it does is it shows your inventory intelligently to in-market buyers in your market, drives that traffic to VDP, and as a result of that high traffic, they convert more readily. But we're not going to spend any more time on that because, frankly, we're here to learn. So let's focus on that factor, and we're going to start with a quick poll question. So think of it this way. You've got a lot of technology at your disposal, so we want to get a bit of an idea of where folks on the call today fit within the spectrum of technologies that you're using. So think of this question as what technology you're dealership is using today to promote your inventory. So here's a few choices, and then Nick will switch over to a polling solution. So Nick, you can go ahead and switch over to the poll, and you can click on one, two, or more of the options there, and we'll get a bit of a hands-up version of what you're using today. So go ahead and do that. And Nick, you just let me know how things are flowing in, and we can pause in probably 30 seconds on that, get your votes down.
All right, and it looks like most people have voted, so here comes the results.
Perfect, and if you can read that off to me, so that everybody else is seeing it, but unfortunately, presenter guy over here doesn't get to have the view, so you go ahead and read those off, Nick.
It's kind of spread across the spectrum of choices. The leading vote getter was digital listings at 36%, followed closely by SEM at 29%. Getting a good amount of votes there, social media at 18%, display at 11%, and finally email at 7%. So the digital listings was the leading vote getter there at 36%.
All right. Well, that's perfect. So it sounds like we were only able to choose one. So the dominant opportunity is that dominant vote getter, digital listings, and then SEM. And we can see that that is fairly consistent. If we jump back to presenter mode for me, Nick, we can see that that is pretty consistent in what we're doing. So the marketplace generally in a dominant force runs with digital listings and search engine marketing. And there's no doubt that that is the standard across the board. You know, when we're talking to customers, we're often getting an understanding of what they are spending in those areas in order to understand what would be an appropriate budget for display advertising, because typically it's a complementary budget that's going to help rise all tides. So just to take a step back from that, when we're talking about how digital listings and SEM have moved down this path, there's been this saturation, this evolutionary period that's taken place over time. So of course, if we go way back, we can see newspaper listings. So someone had this bright idea when they were disseminating news and information on your doorstep to say, hey, let's put some listings into the paper. Well, lo and behold, the Saturday newspaper turned into a giant brick every week, and listings was super popular. That was where you sold cars. I even chatted with a newspaper pundit the other day, and he was still trying to tell me, at his 80 years of age, he's got a lot of knowledge in the space, and still trying to tell me that people are buying there. Well, things have changed somewhat. Specialty auto listings came into play, the likes of the printed Auto Trader and Cars.com and that sort of thing. And then folks caught on pretty quick to listings in the digital environment. Things like Autotrader.com, Cars.com, CarGurus, a variety of digital listings have come into play. And what happens each time is as people move into these environments, more and more people come on board. As we can see, the lion's share of folks chose those areas as the first places they were advertising in, or the primary choice. And then we come, or then comes in, or sort of next to put up its hand, is search engine marketing. All right, so your SEM. And being at that point in the funnel where a consumer is now saying, I want this car in this neighborhood, and I want you to find it for me, Mr. Google Machine. So the Google Machine starts to point out and show the details of what's going on, but that starts to become saturated as well. And that's what we're talking about today. And you know, as a marketer, you're looking into the details on a regular basis, you know that your costs are increasing with consistent regularity. So we'll see what's going on there. That's now becoming saturated. And what it is when everybody's doing the same thing, when you're all doing the same thing, there's this problem. When everybody's doing the same, no one can stand out. It's very difficult to be competitive. And I talk to a lot of people that are saying, you know, I'm trying to find that edge. I feel like I'm being beaten in search engine marketing. And really, it's a budgetary thing. If you can spend more, you obviously there's a lot of technique that goes into it, but if you can spend more, you're likely going to do better. And as you increase spend, well, someone else increases spend, and based on that auction factor, things go up and up and up. So, key point to take away, doing the same thing as your competition doesn't necessarily make you more competitive. It reduces you from becoming less competitive. So you can match, or you can start to go neck and neck, but it's pretty tough to pull away from the crowd. So problem number two is that as more folks come into this marketplace, like I've been saying, the CPC cost starts to increase. So let's look at a little bit of research here to show what's going on there. So, looking at automotive specifically, you can see it across the board, really. There's been significant increases, but if we're looking at automotive, it's 83% increase over the last 3 years if we're going back to 2012 through 2014. So this rise by AdGuru, when they did this survey, they figured out that that increase has been fairly consistent year over year over year. And you're probably noticing that that is fairly consistent. We did a study of our own customer base to see what's going on in the marketplace and what's going on. We work a lot with Google Analytics, so we've got access to be able to understand these things in aggregate. And we can see that, you know, even over the last while, even from Q1 2015 to Q4 2015, we've seen a significant increase. Take for a second a look at the previous slide where I've said, okay, we're looking at $1.57 in 2014. Our research is showing a $2.50 in 2015 of the same quarter. So that's continuing to increase significantly. And that's just the way it goes. Putting that into real terms, though, think of it this way, right? Your approximate clicks that you're getting for the same budget, because the average budget seems to be about $8,000 a month, you're going to get significantly less clicks now than you would have got in 2012. Okay, so lots of new strategies have to be employed, and frankly, more dollars have to be applied to the situation. In fact, you would need $25,000 to get the same amount of clicks as you got in 2012 for $8,000. You know, if that's not a problem, and you know, the tricky part is oftentimes problems are a bit like this. They are a slow boil, and unfortunately that poor frog doesn't know to jump out, doesn't know to make that change. And I'll be very clear with this statement. We don't advocate jumping out of search engine marketing. It's a vital piece of the puzzle. That being said, there's other pieces of the puzzle that you need to explore in order to increase your competitiveness or even remain competitive. So problem number three is Google, of course, is a self-serving entity. Right? The reality is that they're wanting to improve their margin over time. They're wanting to improve their performance over time. So they do things like they just did in February of this year, and they make changes in the marketplace. So you can see that, you know, prior to the change in the marketplace, and you're probably all familiar with this, I hope you are, this is an important piece of the marketing puzzle, you've got three ads and then you go to the right rail. Well, the right rail has gone the way of the dodo bird, and now you've got sometimes a fourth ad, and then additional ads below the fold that show up at the very bottom of the search results on the first page. So this is changing things fairly significantly, and actually some more research is showing us from Columbus Agency is showing us that there is some significant change in the marketplace. And what do they predict, particularly relative to the cost of the click, is that it will increase. Okay, so a few other changes there, and an interesting link down there below. You can read that article at your own leisure. By having a look at this in sort of down the road, you can click on that link once you get this presentation. The reality, and you know, a lot of folks are talking about it, is just frankly speaking, and this is Search Engine Watch talking about this, Google's change is going to increase CPC. So it's not going to adjust that to a certain degree where now, lo and behold, that constant increase in cost is going to be subsided. No, it's going to continue, and frankly, we can look to our friend Mr. Vader here, who's, you know, really just forecasting the reality. You know, just pray I don't alter these things further. The reality is, the likelihood is that there will be other alterations down the road that continuing the prices will continue to go up, and that's, you know, that's just good business for Google and for Google shareholders, but the reality is it makes it tricky for us. Okay, so just to reiterate, those problems, can't do the same thing as everybody else. Frankly, it just doesn't separate you. Dealerships are entering this space where SEM is getting more and more expensive, and obviously Google is a business, and they're going to try to continue to make money as they see fit. So what can we do? I have a great suggestion. Let's do this. All right? Let's just, no, we don't want to do this. We don't want to put our heads in the sand. We've got other things that we can do. We can continue to optimize search engine marketing. You know, a number of you have probably already worked with a variety of different partners to help with your SEM, and you continue to work with those folks to do better and better and better. As well, you should also be looking at new technologies. And this is what we're going to talk about a little bit more today, some greenfield technologies that dealers have to compete with. Okay, so different tools that you can use, as opposed to just doing the same thing and hoping for a better result, right? We all know what that is a little more similar to. So, key point, keep some budget aside. Okay, keep some budget aside to experiment with other technologies. If you're planning your budget to its maximum all the time and you've got everything squared away in these areas that are predictable, well, you may never be able to find that great new opportunity. And there's so many cool technology companies out there coming up with great solutions to help you drive more sales. So by all means, make sure that you put a line item in your budget to be able to do that. All right. So as you're going through these opportunities, you got to figure out, how am I going to measure? And this is one of the constructs that I'm going to provide for you here in this session, that you're going to be able to figure out how you can evaluate and decide on which solutions you want to be working with. So let's think of it this way. Four questions, pretty straightforward. So the first thing I want to figure out, if I'm talking about selling cars, all right, and we always talk about the perspective of selling cars. We don't talk about it from a fixed ops perspective necessarily. We're talking about it from selling cars. So, focused targeting. This new option that I'm trying, this new fandangled technology, someone that's come in my door, someone that's been so persistent that I finally took a meeting with them. Is their targeting focused? Can you be particularly specific in who you serve ads to? So how granular can you get? In our world, we talk about a segment of one, so finding that one individual that matches a car that you've got. So how targeted can you be with your solutions? Engaging creative. What can you do that's going to be engaging or entice that target audience? In our world, we talk about relevancy as being the way to be the most engaging. Obviously, you know, you've got some other tools at your disposal, some animation, some different colors, that sort of thing that are going to respond to more people. But if you can make an ad relevant, you're going to significantly increase the interest or the engagement level of that ad. Then specific, okay, can you actually promote your cars? Can you actually promote the specific vehicles that you have in that marketplace? So there's a lot of new tools and some that we'll look at where you can actually put specific vehicles into your ads in an intelligent manner. And of course, there's other solutions out there that you can just put specific vehicles in a, you know, a less intelligent manner, or I don't want to be so bold as to say unintelligent, but you can randomly put vehicles into your ads too, I suppose. All right, and then low funnel. So how can you make sure, because we are, after all, talking from a tier three perspective, okay, or we're talking from a pre-owned vehicle perspective, independent dealers that are trying to move as many cars as they can from that low funnel perspective. There's no reason for them to talk branding and all that kind of stuff necessarily relative to Ford or GM or Volvo or whatever the case. It's really talking to that consumer who's ready to buy, who is that quote-unquote in-market shopper, ready to pull the trigger. We love those people, right? So one piece that we've put together for you is just a simple worksheet with these points for you to use and reuse to evaluate solutions that you're considering in the marketplace. And that can be found at speedshiftmedia.com. nicksullivich.com/resources. There's a number of other great resources there to help you out, but in particular, relative to what we're talking about today, there is that evaluation worksheet that you can work with. All right. So, ready for some new technologies? Let's have a look at a few pieces that are out there in the marketplace, some interesting stuff to consider. Okay, first piece of the puzzle, bid to position. Okay, so we talk about improving techniques within AdWords, right? That was the one suggestion. Once we have pulled our head out of the sand, we're actually looking at different ways that you can bid within this AdWords space. And there are some very specific things that you can do to bid to position to manage your cost, right? If you're always going for that number one spot, you're bidding pretty high. You're trying to keep everything optimal in the way of relevance, but that can be expensive and it can be prohibitive. So, highly valued keywords at a discounted price, right? If you're bidding for other spots, you can reduce the competition between dealerships and your OEM, right? The OEM is probably going to be at the top spot if you're talking about bidding for Audi 4S, or you know, if you're competing with local franchise stores in the marketplace and you've got your pre-owned vehicles on the lot, there's a significant amount of competition there. So reduce your impact on rising costs of CRM, you can get into some of these pieces, and I'll show you how in a second. But the downside is pretty straightforward. Essentially, it's going to reduce the number of positions that you can get, right? So if you're bidding for that second, third, or fourth spot, if you're trying to do that tactically, you could end up failing and ending up in the fifth, which is down below the fold. Okay, not a great place to hang out. So that's one of the tickly parts of doing this, of performing this effort. The other piece of it is it's a little bit technical. It's not for the novice marketer, right? So it's not for someone that has never played with code. This is the code on the right-hand side, and it is specifically from Google. You can get that code in the AdWords site. So if you do a little bit of searching, or if you want to ask for that link specifically after this presentation, you can do that. But make sure you get someone who really knows what they're doing, or that you have a higher level of understanding within this space, but you can actually start to bid and target for those positions. So let's evaluate that with these four pieces. So focused targeting, engaging creative, and specific and low funnel. Okay, so this piece of the puzzle, focused targeting, yeah, absolutely. I mean, that's the beauty of Google AdWords, is the shopper is determining what they see effectively. They are punching in keywords to say, I'm interested in this specific thing, show it to me. That's why we love AdWords, okay? Engaging creative. Let's be clear, a text ad will never be as engaging as anything visual or video or anything like that, so the engagement level is going to be pretty far on the low side. Now, that said, we were talking about relevancy, so it could be relevant, but you know, still it is text. VIN specific, okay? So there's tools out there in the marketplace that can enable you to be VIN specific, but you can't typically do it yourself. You got to find outside tools, work with dynamic ads, that kind of thing. So for the most part, your ads in this format are not going to land on VDP or SRP, right? So then you have that customer coming to a landing page or a home page that has to make their way through, and unfortunately you get a lot of drop off when they're trying to make through that travel through your site. Okay, and are they low funnel? Yeah, I mean, if a person is looking for a store in their marketplace to find the particular vehicle, absolutely. So if you're getting into long tail sort of keywords, that kind of thing, absolutely they can be low funnel. If they're looking at, you know, a lot of dealers that we talk to don't buy brand. They don't buy their specific brand name because they leave that to the OEM. It doesn't make a ton of sense. So for yourselves, you know, selling those vehicles, you want to consider what pieces of the puzzle you want to be bidding most on to ensure that you're low funnel. All right, so another googly thing. This is kind of a fun piece of the puzzle, and I trust that you can see the video running on the side. Nick, do let me know if you can't see the video rolling on the side. Otherwise, no worries. You can just keep mum the word kind of thing. So what is this? This is a new ad type that's come out from Google in the last little while focused on the mobile shopper. Okay, there's no doubt that mobile is taking a really big space in the digital consumer's path, right? So people are making decisions when they're sitting in the store, they're making decisions before they come to the store, all these different pieces. Now, what's interesting here is this enables typically OEMs to make year, make, model keywords and to show up with these pieces on the right-hand side, okay? Pretty interesting piece of the puzzle. You can actually click on that link when you get the presentation and read more details after the fact. But this is, you know, segregated to a few other pieces of the puzzle. So why is it good? Okay, so much search these days, 50% of automotive search is on mobile. Now, you got to keep in mind that most of the time, those searches are relative to location, phone number, and other sort of more snacking type items. There's not as much detailed, heavy research done within mobile phone, but the reality is it's an important piece of the puzzle for you to be present. Okay, these ads currently are only available at the OEM level. Okay, so there may be solutions there for you, but you've got that dealer spot. So if you are a franchise dealer selling pre-owned vehicles, then you're able to be featured in one of these ads with your OEM. For independents, tough to get into this space, but interesting nonetheless, and an interesting thing to be aware of when you're competing. Again, buying that keyword that is 2016 Toyota Prius, if this ad type is over top of yours, the likelihood of getting your action on the typical text ad below it is going to be reduced. And that really gets into the why it's not so good sort of stuff. Okay? Great for new cars, great for new models, but a lot trickier for that pre-owned piece of the puzzle. And think of it this way, the link is likely only going to get to a model-specific page and likely within the OEM world. So it's earlier funnel kind of stuff, as we'll see in this evaluation. So focus targeting, again, the four factors: focus targeting, engaging creative, VIN specific, and low funnel. Okay, so focus targeting, yeah, again, like previous search, this is just a different kind of search ad, so people are going to be putting their hand up. Is the creative engaging? Yeah, absolutely. I mean, with all of those pictures, with all those pieces of the puzzle, it's a pretty neat feature-rich ad, and Google is doing more and more things. Like, you probably noticed the last time you typed a question into Google AdWords, my wife and I were in the process of catching up on Game of Thrones, trying to see what all the hype's about. Well, we just finished season 3 yesterday, and I wanted to know whether the episode we were watching was the last one. So I typed into Google, and I said, okay, Google, how many episodes in season 3 of Game of Thrones? And it didn't take me to a website or any kind of ad or anything like that. It just gave me the answer right there. It said 10. Okay? So that's the kind of thing that Google is doing more and more, is taking these primary questions and these top key aspects and putting that into the top. And that's similar to what this ad is doing. VIN specific. No way. Okay, so being able to have a VIN-specific ad that's going to take you to VDP in this case is not going to happen. So the best bet is that you're going to maybe able to get someone to SRP, but most likely it's going to be homepage of your store. Is it low funnel? Well, I think that one's debatable. We're talking about yes here, that you know the assumption is that if they're clicking on the dealership button that they are low funnel, right? So it's the ad itself can be seen by people way earlier, but your engagement, what you're most interested in, is getting them to your store to see your pre-owned vehicles, okay, or your new vehicles if you're a new vehicle dealer on this call. Either way. All right, next. We have got Facebook ads, the almighty Facebook, okay? So it's interesting to see, you know, Facebook and Google have really been the only ones making real money in this space, okay, in digital advertising for consumer. And, you know, Twitter's been trying, there's a few other social environments that are trying hard, but, you know, Facebook is frankly giving Google a run for its money. So let's have a look at this. What is this exactly? Okay, so here we've got Facebook as a channel for your dealer inventory. So there are a number of solutions out there where you can get your inventory, you can upload your inventory into the Facebook environment and start to promote those vehicles and enable people to click through from those vehicles to your site. So you can do that manually, you can do that using a feed into the Facebook environment, and you can do that in retargeted efforts. I know Pure Cars has a solution for that, which is pretty neat. So why is it good? All right, so as of Q4, Facebook is boasting a huge amount of the population. Right, there's all sorts of targeting options, which is great. You can have really like targeting options till you're blue in the face. A fun example is you can actually, when I talk about that segment of one, if you're feeling tricky, take the time to figure out what your partner, your spouse, your husband, your wife, whatever the case, figure out what segment they would be on their own. It could be their employment, their age, their, you know, social demographic, all that kind of stuff. You can probably segment your significant other or people in your family and show them specific ads. That's how granular you can get within Facebook, and that's pretty cool, no doubt about it. So you can also target in the way of conquest, okay? You can target folks, target different brands or brand consideration. And you can also get down to that model level and provide a blend of vehicles within the interest of that consumer. So there's lots of neat things that you can do there. Downside of it, a little bit, so lots of effort to set up. Okay, so the other piece is frankly too many targeting options, right? So when you've got all the options in the world and you start to segment that, you can actually segment yourself into segmentation hell. Kind of thing where you're getting into these crazy worlds of trying to overly segment, or you have too broad a segment and you can't focus your ads. It can really get tricky back and forth because you as a human being are setting those parameters. You can find like audience and that sort of stuff as well, which is pretty neat, but you're setting those parameters as opposed to letting some machine learning, okay, so a computer system that's looking at all the algorithms as a consumer's known interest, figure out what they're interested in. That can often be easier effectively on you and your efforts. And then the other piece is getting that inventory into the system. So, you know, finding solutions in any of these cases where getting the inventory onboarding process down to a really easy way for us. That's one of the features in our business. It is dead easy. You know, we basically look at two web pages a night on your website, and we've got all your inventory to serve ads the next day. So no additional cost. It just makes life a little bit more simple. So the other piece of the puzzle is that precise targeting. You know, we talked about that double-edged sword, and you know, without being too specific, okay, your results can end up being very similar to other display offerings. Okay, so when you're, think of it this way, when you're not being segmented enough, you can just put an ad out there to, you know, maybe a female audience, 65 plus, you know, my grandmother in that category, she would maybe be served a Honda CR-V or a Toyota Corolla. Well, she's a Dodge Charger kind of girl. So it's pretty tricky to segment based on sort of demographic and psychographic and think that you're going to get the right answer relative to someone's vehicular interests. So let's look at this on the rating system so we can focus again on those four pieces of the puzzle. Focus targeting, does it have engaging creative, can it be VIN specific, and can it be low funnel? Okay, so focus targeting, can the targeting be tightly focused? Yes, absolutely. You can be hyper-focused, as we have talked about. Can you have engaging creative? Yeah, there's all sorts of options there, and particularly interesting is you can put vehicles in there. You know, the car is the star is often a term that one of our customers likes to use, and you know, that idea is being able to get those vehicles in front of the right people. VIN-specific, okay. Recently, as I mentioned on the retargeting side, that is becoming possible. Okay, previously that's been quite difficult, but there's new offerings coming up from Facebook. You can actually do it yourself right through Facebook, which is kind of cool if you want to take that time. But there's folks out there providing that service too. Low funnel, okay. Is this a low funnel opportunity? It depends, right? If you can actually see what that consumer's known interests are and get into their understanding of their path to purchase, you may be able to figure out low funnel, but for the most part, you're only trusting Facebook data. And Facebook data isn't necessarily capable of attesting whether that consumer is low funnel or not. All right, so let's get into dynamic inventory. So dynamic inventory is kind of a fun piece that's come into play in the last little while. Of course, we're super excited about it. We've been doing dynamic display for over 10 years. You know, effectively pioneered the space, and you know, that's sometimes the downside of being on the bleeding edge of technology. Well, it takes time for folks to catch up and get excited about what we do. Here is an environment where there is a lot of excitement about that piece of the puzzle, and you can see, you know, being able to look at multiple pieces of inventory and scroll through those. That's kind of a nice piece. Conversely, you know, having ad on the left-hand side where you're just looking at that hero shot of the car, you know, is that as engaging as a highly targeted vehicle that's going to show you exactly what you're interested in? Okay, so let's have a look at some of the what is it. I've already described it a little bit, but using display as a channel, you know, there's new pieces of display that actually make display more feature-rich and more capable of delivering real value, particularly being able to choose the right vehicle, show it to a customer, and have that view details button that you see on the right-hand side click directly to that Audi Q5, that specific make, model, year, price, like that exact car is what they get to click to, and that's a pretty nice offering out there in the marketplace. So pros, huge reach. wider than Facebook and search combined. And that's a real important piece of the puzzle. I'll dwell on this point for a moment because, you know, oftentimes people say, okay, well, I really want to focus on search and I really want to get going in Facebook. Well, lo and behold, search is 10% of the online time spent, 10% of the audience. Okay, Facebook is 15%. Okay, so 15% of time spent online is in the Facebook world. Yes, those are really big for single sites, but there's still a huge amount of websites that are untouched in that area where all display, intelligent display, can run. So 75% is open to dynamic inventory display, right? Being able to run these standard IAB-sized ad units and other more exciting in-image ad units in these environments. So it's pretty neat to be able to do. So there you go, pro. Run on any website. Very targeted, depending on the behavioral targeting and machine learning available from the vendor that you choose to work with, okay, you're able to get quite granular in that targeting. As I said, we talk about a segment of one, finding that exact individual that's interested in the cars that you've got on the lot. And that, important to note, is without them ever having been to your store. This is not a retargeting specific solution. Okay, and then able to determine where they are in the buyer's journey, right? So again, through machine learning and that behavioral targeting, figure out when they're heating up as a potential buyer and focusing our attention on them, right? Focusing the attention of your dollars on that heated up consumer. Okay, so let's look at the cons in the marketplace here. So we've got performance of each vendor is probably going to be dependent. You know, we certainly like to say that if you've been in the game for a long, long time, you probably got it pretty well figured out. But you're going to see varying performance from dynamic vendor to dynamic vendor. Oftentimes, people talk about a dynamic ad being served where it's actually a static piece of creative served dynamically. So there's a big difference there where a consumer looking at an ad is only shown the specific ad that was related to their time on the VDP of the dealer, and they're shown one ad as opposed to what's going on in certain cases where it's an ad tag, and then that frame, like this frame of this open road Audi Vancouver ad, is being filled dynamically for the specific user looking at those specific vehicles, so looking at those Q5s, because that's what's been determined by the system as their interest. Okay. Creating these ads manually, absolutely prohibitive. You know, it's a piece that we've talked to a lot of folks about. Many folks that we've run into through the years have said, oh my gosh, that's exactly, like I've been trying to build that for years. And we just say, well, okay, but now you don't have to. So we can help you with that. So, you know, trying to build those on your own is really tough. Behavioral targeting, okay, super key. Consider this. As I was talking about the plethora of sites that you're going to want to show on, you know, not all sites are going to be able to, or not all providers are going to be able to have that behavioral targeting. For us, if you're looking at, you know, the ESPN or New York Times or the local newspaper.com, that behavioral targeting, if it's present, okay, so it's a con, of course, if it's not present, but if it's present, you're still able to show the exact vehicle to the right consumer based on what the system has learned about that consumer. So important pieces in those cons there to look for if they're not present. And lo and behold, we're talking about great evaluation here. So focus targeting, again, we're looking at engaging creative, VIN specific, and low funnel. So focus targeting, right, where we're talking about the pieces here is, you know, yes or no, depending on who you've selected as your partner in this respect is going to vary the targeting capabilities. So being able to find those consumers in the general web landscape is going to be dependent on the behavioral targeting and machine learning that they've got built into their systems, into their ad serving systems. Engaging creative, yes, absolutely. You know, HTML5 creative that's going to work on mobile, tablet, you know, all the different devices. And of course, it's going to have some nice animation, all that kind of good stuff to let people know that there's multiple vehicles for them to look at. But most important in engaging creative is relevancy. So again, going back to that behavioral machine learning, making sure that you're showing the creative that is most relevant to that consumer. VIN specific, so can these ads be VIN specific? Yeah, you can show a lot of inventory dynamically in an ad, but if you don't have multiple click tags, it's not going to be VIN specific. So that's a little on the technical side, but effectively what that means is that every single picture, every single tile of the different vehicles has an entirely new URL, a web address, that that consumer is going to click to, and that is going to be specific to the vehicle detail page of that particular vehicle. And then again, is it low funnel? So it's low funnel. Typically, people buying display, and when you've bought display ads in the past, you've probably thought of it as a branding opportunity. So technology has made it possible for this to be a very tactical opportunity and very low funnel based on truly understanding where that consumer is at in the decision-making process. So if they're going down this path and they've now heated up to a degree that they're looking at so many pieces of the puzzle and they're comparing between two vehicles and two stores, well, we know that we need to hit that customer pretty hard to encourage them to visit the right store, right? Remember, they're only visiting one store these days when they make their purchase decision. Everything else happens before that. Everything else happens on the web. All right, so let's look at a just general technical summary of these four options and consider that you can use this framework that we've got again at speedshiftmedia.com/resources. You can download the simple sheet, which is effectively the framework tool that you can use to make decisions based on any other opportunity, okay? Be it bid position, AdWords, Facebook, or dynamic inventory ads, you can use it in any of these. You can also use it in other tools as well. So we can see that across the board when we compare those, let's just look at the bottom row, the totals. So bid position is going to be dependent on your capability and on who you're working with as a partner potentially. So it's either a 2 or a 4, so anywhere in between 2 and 4. Google AdWords, the autos ad that we showed, that great new pictorial ad that's come out in the marketplace, okay, between a 3 and a 4, and dependent based on whether you're a franchise store selling pre-owned vehicles or an independent store, so that's going to have varying degrees of benefit for yourself. On the Facebook side of things, so an important piece there is, finding the right folks to work with there, but also figuring out how to make the Facebook systems work for you. So there's interesting pieces there, again, between a 2 and a 4. And really the pieces that are tricky are VIN-specific and whether you can actually, get them into that low funnel stage. Dynamic inventory, so focused targeting, again, is going to be relative to the behavioral and machine learning capabilities of your partner. Engaging creative, for sure, particularly based on relevancy, again, touching on that behavioral aspect. VIN specific, yeah, absolutely. You know, some are a single VIN specific and lose that capability when that car sells, that kind of thing, if it's a static ad. So you want to be working with someone that's got dynamic ad capabilities that are truly dynamic, so the ad itself is being populated at the time the ad is served, so in real time. And then low funnel. Again, that stems back, you know, it's funny, it all stems back to data. And that really is the nature of the beast these days. It all stems back to data where you need to make your choices relative to the capabilities of the teams that you're working with from a data perspective. What can they do with the information they have? Is it primary data? Are they depending on someone else to help them with it, right? So that primary data is a really nice factor. That automotive specific data is a really nice factor. And those are all things that are going to help you deliver a better dynamic inventory ad. Okay, so let's pause there on those evaluations and take a look at a digital mix. So previously the mix, you know, we talked to so many folks in the marketplace and so often it's listings and search. Okay, those are the dominant forces. Okay, we're actually seeing in the marketplace listings is decreasing a little bit, and that's, you know, when we look at the marketplace and we see the changes, that's obviously a big reason why we spend a lot of time as a company now working direct with dealers or working with agency partners of dealers to support dealers directly. Okay, there's changes going on in that marketplace. SEM, super valuable and will continue to be for a long time, obviously, for that low funnel. When someone's searching for that car, you'll want to be there. Social, you know, the old way was a little softer. Okay, so you can see here it was a little softer initially, and things are starting to heat up a little bit as we can do a bit more in this new media mix that we're suggesting. Display also has been really soft. When it's purely focused on branding, okay, when you're purely focused on saying, you know, you've been in business for 30 years or you've got some great financing rate, you're pretty tricky to get action on that. But when you can show the specifically relevant vehicle and drive that customer to a vehicle detail page, you can afford to spend more significantly there. In fact, results that are being discovered in display, intelligent, highly intelligent display, are starting to rival that of search engine marketing. Okay, so you know those two now going hand in glove, where you can get some branding value from display, but drive the performance or similar performance levels to SEM gets pretty exciting, having that 1-2 punch at play. social increasing a little bit, and then this bottom row. Okay, we're being kind of nice in saying that typically the old way was to have some experimental budget. Let's be real here. Most folks don't keep that experimental kitty around to be able to test things with. Okay, super important to be able to have that within your budget and plan for that all the time to be able to make some room for experimentation. Okay, so let's get into just a quick summary and then we will get on to questions. I hope there's a few that have been coming through the system here. So SEM is getting more and more competitive every day and more expensive, right? So that's the obvious piece of the puzzle. We as a advertising group, as a body of people who are trying to promote vehicle sales as digital marketers, we need to find new ways to engage with shoppers in that path to purchase. At the right points in that path to purchase, right? With that in-market shopper, we don't want to spend all that money early funnel. We want to get them when they're ready to buy. Okay, we want to effectively evaluate these solutions, so we've given you a little bit of a tool set to effectively evaluate those. Again, you can download that at speedshiftmedia.com/resources. And then lastly, making sure that you have budget around to experiment with solutions, okay, to try new things and not to be afraid of your marketing mix. Digital is about test and measure, okay, trying new things, seeing how they work, and adding them to your solution while you take away from other areas. Okay, the days of needing to buy a huge amount of premium listings in third-party listing is changing, right? So now you want to drive your own traffic, create your own leads. There's other ways to do that. Okay, again, I'd be remiss if I didn't remind you about who we are and what we do, so feel free to reach out to us to talk about the Auto Audience Network. That is our wheelhouse where we make display actually work, which is pretty exciting. And now I open it up to as many questions as you've got available, but if we go over time, please feel free to send them to me. And once we get started on the questions, I will just put up my contact information in case you want to send them direct or via the team at Auto Remarketing. So, Nick, thank you. Thank you very much.
Excellent presentation, Ian. And just a reminder that we are recording today's webinar. And keep watch of your inbox for a link to that recording so you can go through all of the great information again that Ian has shared with us and perhaps shared around your dealership. Let some of the other managers take a look and everyone can collaborate together on what the next plan of action should be. And as Ian mentioned, please use the questions box on the GoToWebinar control panel to submit your questions, and we'll get to as many as we can here in the time that we have set aside here. So Ian, just to get us started, just to recap, a dealer is asking how are these digital ads charged on a cost per click or a CPM basis? How are dealerships paying for these services?
Great question. Okay, you know, it's interesting. There's a lot of different methods out there. I'll speak to you know, you've got of the things that we showed. Most of them are a cost per click basis. Though I know a lot of folks in the display marketplace are still showing on a CPM basis. Ourselves at SpeedShift Media and with the Auto Audience Network, we've moved to a pay-for-performance model similar to search engine marketing where we charge on a cost-per-click basis. The important piece there, though, is when you plan your program that you plan for enough of a budget to make an impact on what you're doing. Oftentimes we'll chat with folks and they're thinking that they want to stick their toe in. Make sure, and we often do, and when you're checking with other suppliers, that kind of thing, make sure that you're sticking your whole foot in or even your leg so that you can get a true valuation of what it is that you're doing. But you know, most of these are on a pay-for-performance basis, and we believe that's the way to go.
Okay, great. Another submitted question here from a dealer is, how can you compare display results to the results of a search campaign when the CTRs are reading as they are? Well, how would you recommend that dealer go forward?
Okay, super question. That's great. So, you know, we spend a lot of time talking about researching and educating people on how to measure and understand the performance of that campaign in a more apples-to-apples way. it's our belief, and shared more and more by the folks that we discuss this with across the board, certainly you know, with pundits out there in the marketplace, you know, like Brian Pash and Glenn Pash, the folks at PCG, like you know, Ralph, actually I'm going to forget his surname now, so a lot of folks out there talking about the same sort of idea, where you want to be able to assess the performance of your campaigns based on how many cars, what types of time spent with cars, and all those pieces are being valued and viewed. So what that means is assessing not just the click-through rate, and in fact, in our world, we kind of, even though we've got quite a high click-through rate, we talk about being quite irrelevant because we're responsible for driving performance after the click. And we actually assess campaigns based on Google Analytics performance of post-click activity. What that means is we're looking at how many people look at, spend time with, how much time they spend, and how many, specifically vehicle detail pages, that that consumer is looking at. Think of it this way. If you're spending $2.50 on a click from AdWords that's going to your home page or a custom landing page, the consumer then needs to move through 2, 3, or 4 different pages to get to a piece of inventory. From our research, we see that only about 20 to 25%, sometimes less, of those consumers from that click actually get to a vehicle detail page. What that means is you need to spend 4 times or 5 times that $2.50 to get a single vehicle detail page view. So when you're measuring your programs and you're measuring it versus a traffic source that can drive traffic directly to a vehicle detail page, that every click is either going to a vehicle detail page or a search results page, you're going to see significantly more value and significantly more traffic on VDP. That's where this excitement has come about, of being able to get technology sources that are going to drive traffic directly to those hidden pages of your vehicle inventory. So to summarize, and we can go into more of that, there's actually some lots of great research and a setup guide on speedshiftmedia.com/resources. There's a VDP measurement setup guide, Google Analytics setup guide. But the one-line answer, sorry to drag it out, the one-line answer is measure vehicle detail page traffic, okay, and understand what's happening on your VDPs. You're trying to sell cars. Make sure people are looking at cars based on what you're spending to drive that activity.
Excellent. Speaking here is Ian Cruikshank, who's the Vice President of Sales and Marketing for SpeedShift Media, and we're in the Q&A section of our webinar today, The Digital Marketer Survival Guide, How to Manage the Declining Returns from SEM. And during your presentation, Ian, you touched on Facebook and the impact that platform can have, and a dealer is curious whether it's a worthwhile avenue for the store to pursue advertising on Instagram, the other social media platform under the Facebook umbrella. How would you recommend that store proceed with regard to Instagram?
Great, and thank you for that question. And you know, like I've said throughout, digital is about test and measure. And that framework that we've provided that you can download is about figuring out what those metrics are that are important to you. And we've suggested 4. You may add a couple more that are important to you based on your internal metrics. Instagram would be a great thing to put into that measure and try it over a 90-day or even 6-month period. Okay. Most recently, I spoke at a conference out in Philadelphia or actually New Jersey, and we talked a lot about the fact that consumers in the marketplace, the dealer consumers specifically, so dealers need to work with their partners or work with the chosen activity for a long enough period of time to truly assess the value of it. And I would say that with Instagram, well, I don't have a straight answer to say you should or you shouldn't, because I think the performance is going to be dependent on how it's executed. You know, if you've got a lot of followers, if you've created an audience out there and you can actually work with that space to communicate with people, then your effectiveness is going to be improved if you can find the right things that are going to entice them in that environment. Certainly, they're trying to make it go similar to Twitter, you know, the activities there to increase their effectiveness, but it's going to take time to figure that out. So again, I would say go for it, but test and measure carefully.
Excellent, excellent. And another solution-oriented question has come in, Ian, asking about whether there's a tool or a platform that can follow the customer immediately that day and match the inventory that corresponds to their interest. I guess, again, pinpointing, trying to coordinate the customer interest with what might be on the lot. How would you recap again what tools might work for them?
Okay, so I would focus on this. If you've got a good retargeting solution, you want to make sure, or frankly, to highlight what a good retargeting solution is it's one that can understand what the consumer is looking at and then show them specifically similar or the same vehicles. You know, the approach that we take is to show customers a couple of the vehicles that they've seen on your lot as well as many vehicles they haven't seen. Right, you're obviously going to have other cars on the lot that they haven't looked at, but more importantly, and I think where your question is alluding to a little bit more, is when that customer is in market performing all of these activities, is there a solution or a platform that can show them the right car? And you know, I feel a little sheepish saying that, you know, exactly that is what the Auto Audience Network does, but that's the reality of it. So thank you for that question. But the kicker is being able to figure out what that consumer is interested in before they come to your store. So when they're researching, when they're looking at reviews, when they're looking at listing sites, all of those things are going to plug into, that information plugs into the Auto Audience Network's data management platform, our proprietary DMP, and it's going to say this consumer is interested in this car that you've got on the lot. We then show them that car. So that is very much available in the marketplace today, and that's really the cornerstone of what we do. Outside of that, you know, honestly, I hazard to find another solution that works in a similar way or in the same way, but folks are, you know, feverishly trying to catch up to the technology we hold. So keep your eyes peeled and let me know when you do see one, please.
Excellent, excellent. That's Ian Cruikshank. He's the VP of Sales and Marketing at SpeedShift Media. His contact information is there on the screen, both phone numbers and email to be able to follow up with him as you see fit. And in our closing moments here, Ian, perhaps another element that needs to be touched on is which of these techniques and solutions are compliant? If you can discuss the how the regulators view these tools and how dealers can use them in a way that abides by regulatory guidelines.
Okay, great question. So there's a lot of ways to get to compliance. I can speak most specifically to our world. So what we've done, actually, we handle co-op solutions for Auto Trader and Edmunds.com and a number of other publishers. We actually manage their co-op systems. And so as a result, we take a lot of that knowledge and run it through our own systems to ensure eligibility and compliance. Outside of that, listings, very difficult to get to be compliant. Facebook, very difficult to get to be compliant. Even AdWords, you know, in certain cases you can work through, you know, like if you're working through a certified vendor for your Chrysler program or for your Ford program, you can get some compliance in the way of AdWords, but typically that's going to be program specific. So for compliant display ad solutions, yes, absolutely, that's something that we can help you with, but there's a lot of nuance to that, so finding folks that can help you more effectively is going to be a good way to focus your attention.
Very good, and that's Ian Cruikshank, the VP of Sales and Marketing with SpeedShift Media. We'll close it out here, Ian, perhaps with a bottom line question is just, Which method would you recommend for boosting specific vehicles on my lots, and as well as any closing thoughts that you'd like to leave about this topic?
Sounds good. So two pieces of the puzzle. One, to be to ensure that I'm not being overly self-serving, I would say that if you can spend time finding a good dynamic search engine marketing provider, being that you can upload your inventory and show that information to the consumer that's specifically searching with those keywords, and that in a display function is exactly what we do. And being able to match that acute degree of relevancy with what vehicles you have on the lot to the consumer's known interests is head and shoulders more performant than other solutions that you'll find. So finding that great dynamic SEM provider and dynamic display provider will put you in very good stead.
Excellent way to close out the discussion, Ian. Thank you so much for all the great recommendations. And just a reminder that we have recorded today's session, so please keep watch of your inbox for a recording, a link to the recording, so you can go through the material and share it with others at your store. So that's Ian Cruikshank with SpeedShift Media. Thank you so much for the great presentation.
Outstanding, Nick. Thank you very much, and thank you all for joining the presentation. Feel free to reach out if you've got a direct question after the fact. Bye for now.
And thank you so much for joining us.